Complications in Late Pregnancy Part 2. In this installation, we hope to introduce another commonly encountered complication in late pregnancy, diabetes mellitus. We hope that the viewer learns to understand the pathophysiology, implications, diagnosis, and management of diabetes mellitus. Diabetes mellitus in pregnancy may be divided into pre-existing diabetes mellitus as well as gestational diabetes mellitus. Pre-existing diabetes mellitus is known as diabetes mellitus diagnosed prior to pregnancy. This may be type 1 or type 2. Gestational diabetes mellitus is defined as any degree of glucose intolerance with onset or first recognition during pregnancy. Diagnosis is made either when a symptomatic patient has random blood sugar levels of more than 11.1 on two separate occasions, or when an asymptomatic patient has a second hour oral glucose tolerance test result of more than 7.8. Gestational diabetes mellitus has an incidence of 7% in all pregnancies. Pathogenesis involves diabetogenic placental hormones which reduce beta cell pancreatic function and increase insulin resistance, resulting in increased insulin demands during pregnancy. Predisposing factors include previous history of gestational diabetes, macrosomia, shoulder dystocia, recurrent miscarriages, intrauterine deaths, stillbirths, family history of diabetes in the first degree relative, advanced maternal age of more than 35, obesity with a BMI of more than 30, polycystic ovarian syndrome, current pregnancy with glycosuria, accelerated fetal growth, or polyhydramnios. Screening for gestational diabetes mellitus should be performed for the high-risk population at 24 to 28 weeks via a 2-hour oral glucose tolerance test. Gestational diabetes mellitus has an important impact on pregnancy and may have both maternal and fetal implications, especially if not well controlled. Maternal implications include susceptibility to infection, increased risks of developing hypertensive disorders in pregnancy, increased likelihood of cesarean delivery, postpartum hemorrhage, and persistent diabetes mellitus post-delivery. Fetal implications include fetal macrosomia, shoulder dystocia, sudden intrauterine death, as well as neonatal complications such as hypoglycemia, respiratory distress syndrome, transient tachypnea of the newborn,
polycythemia,
jaundice, and electrolyte disturbances. Management of gestational diabetes mellitus, like hypertensive disorders, should always involve a multidisciplinary team, which includes the primary obstetrician, an endocrinologist, a dietitian, and a diabetic nurse educator. The aim of optimal management is to achieve and maintain a euglycemic state with minimal fluctuations. This may involve lifestyle modifications such as dietary restriction, a 1800 kilocalorie per day diet is recommended, as well as exercise. If these measures prove insufficient, an insulin regime may be commenced. This usually involves both short-acting and long-acting insulin, and the dosage is titrated individually with help of daily 7-point blood sugar profile monitoring. Maternal surveillance. The patient should be taught how to monitor her own hypocount at home and what measures to take when the hypocount is too high or too low. Regular follow-up should be scheduled with the endocrinologist to assess adequacies of glycemic control and determine the necessity of insulin titration. The dietitian always plays an important role in reinforcing dietary restrictions and yet achieving optimal weight gain. As patients with gestational diabetes mellitus often have some form of hypertensive disorder in pregnancy, they should be screened at every opportunity. Fetal surveillance. Regular growth scans should be performed to watch for signs of accelerated fetal growth, which may imply suboptimal glycemic control and predispose towards macrosomia and complications of shoulder dystocia. Regular monitoring of amniotic fluid index should be performed to detect polyhydramnios. Delivery. The timing of delivery for diet-controlled gestational diabetes mellitus is by 40 weeks, and for insulin-controlled gestational diabetes mellitus is 38 weeks gestation. The mode of delivery may be vaginal, or cesarean section if there is a high likelihood of fetal macrosomia with possibility of shoulder dystocia. In the immediate postpartum period, for patients on insulin, the insulin should be discontinued. A 6-week postnatal oral glucose tolerance test should be performed to differentiate patients with established diabetes mellitus from those with solely gestational induced diabetes mellitus. Patients should also be adequately counseled on lifestyle modifications and the propensity towards development of diabetes mellitus in later life and recurrent gestational diabetes mellitus in subsequent pregnancies.